All right, as promised, this is the bonus material for this week's episode of Live Free FM. The questions that I will be going over in this segment came directly from Mark Stevens at markstevens.net, markstevens.net. You can acquire the script that I'm going over in this segment directly from his website. It has these questions and many, many more. I personally have found Mark's approach to be one of the most effective out there and one of the most simple to understand, so I really like it, and I wanted to share this with you guys. Although I did end up losing this case, the audio from it is probably some of the best audio that I've gotten so far that explains and exemplifies how crooked some of these judges can be when it comes to taking your money for a victimless crime.
For the city of Fort Collins, Colorado. Please stand.
She has to pause and start over because I never stand when the judge enters the courtroom. Just my personal preference, but I don't respect these people. I don't respect their authority. I don't respect what they're doing, so I do not stand for them.
Municipal Court for the city of Fort Collins, Colorado is now in session. Judge Kathleen M. Lane presiding.
So respect for the system issue.
Again, referring to the fact that I did not stand, but of course, I do not have respect for their system.
All right, do you want to go ahead and step up to the podium there? For the record, it is November 8th of 2010. Are you Nathaniel Fraser?
I'm called back, yes.
All right, so you are here for arraignment on case number, or summons number P0006126. This is a camera radar red light summons and complaint. And the clerk had to review the written advisement form on this charge. This is from July 14th of 2010 is the date of violation listed on the summons. A charge of section 1101 subsection 1 of the city traffic code. And speeding 40 miles an hour in a 30 mile an hour zone, 10 miles over the posted limit is the specific charge. A 0 point defense because of the state law that relates to the camera radar red light type enforcement. So the the clerk had to review the advisement form with that 0 point speeding charge checked. And it looks like you reviewed that and indicated that you had questions that you wanted to ask with regard to your rights and options. So go ahead with your question.
So what she's speaking of is the consent form, or the form that they make you fill out saying that you understand your rights and you understand the proceedings. And of course, I don't, because all of it seems like a bunch of hogwash to me. So in order to get to the point where I can ask the judge the questions I want to ask, I usually take the approach of, I don't really understand this, and would I be able to speak with the judge in order to have full understanding so that I may enter a knowing and voluntary plea. This is usually fine with the clerk and usually fine with the judge because they have no idea what kind of questions I'm about to start asking.
Actually, I have questions pertaining to the nature and cause of these proceedings.
Okay, go ahead.
I would prefer to speak with the district attorney, but if I can just ask you my questions, is that okay?
That's fine.
Okay. First of all, am I entitled to a fair and meaningful hearing?
Yes.
Am I entitled to be informed of the nature and cause of the charges against me?
You are, and you have been in this written advisement form here.
Okay, am I entitled to responsive answers to any questions I might have about the charges?
Certainly. And let me back up a moment and say that the district attorney who you referenced does not handle municipal court cases.
Okay.
In municipal court, the prosecutor is from the city attorney's office and referred to as a municipal court prosecutor or assistant
right.
city attorney.
So it's a city attorney then?
City attorney's office provides prosecution, yes.
Okay. And is the burden of proof on the city attorney during these proceedings?
On the city, yes.
Okay. Is this court bound by Supreme Court rulings?
Certainly.
Okay, and is it bound by the constitutions of Colorado and the United States?
Certainly.
Okay. What rules, if any, govern these proceedings?
There are the Colorado Municipal Court Rules of Procedure that are adopted by the Colorado Supreme Court. There are also some procedural issues addressed in the state statutes.
Okay, and you have to comply with all of these rules?
Certainly.
Okay.
There are also some provisions within the city code itself with regard to that applied to traffic infractions specifically, as well as camera radar cases.
So all of those questions were basically just to set her into a box that she wouldn't be able to work her way out of. I asked about the Constitution and the Supreme Court rulings to basically set it up to where she had to follow or be bound by the Constitution and the Supreme Court rulings, which of course she didn't, but she gave me lip service and said she would. I also asked her about whether I was entitled to be fully informed of the nature and cause of the charges and proceedings against me. And the reason that I asked her that is because once I start asking more questions that she doesn't want to answer, she's already put herself in the double bind where she said she couldn't get a plea from me unless I knew or I was fully informed. And if she refuses to answer my questions, she's refusing to make me fully informed or allow me to be fully informed. And thus, she's putting herself in the position where she can't even accept a plea from me, which is eventually what happens.
And you said that this court is consistent with the Constitution's and Supreme Court rulings. Is the ticket that I was issued consistent with the Constitution's and Supreme Court rulings?
Well, you could certainly make an argument that it's not.
I'm not making an argument. I'm just asking a question.
This is something that they do to me all the time. They accuse me of arguing when all I'm doing is asking questions as if these people are not literate and do not understand the difference between a question and an argument. And she does this multiple times to me.
Well, that would be an argument that the city would need to respond to, the prosecution.
That's kind of why I wanted to talk to the prosecutor, actually.
So if there's some kind of motion you want to file, then the prosecution would need to be here to argue.
Well, I might move to dismiss, but I have a couple more questions I'd like to get answered, if that's okay.
And there she does a very classic diversionary tactic that they like to take. She knows damn well that the ticket is not consistent with the Constitution. It does not allege a violation of a known legal right. It does not allege any sort of injury. She knows that it's not consistent with Supreme Court rulings, which declare that a crime must have corpus delicti. And she knows that the ticket does not allege corpus delicti. But rather than answering the question honestly, she diverts me to the prosecutor, which is something that they like to do a lot. The judge will divert me to the prosecutor will divert me to the police officer. It's always a game of handing you off to the next lowest man on the totem pole, so if you do get your case dismissed, they can blame it on the guy underneath them and avoid making themselves look bad.
Is there an allegation of injury with this particular citation?
Injury to an individual?
An allegation of injury at all?
I would have to have the prosecution respond to that question.
Okay.
All I have is the face of the ticket itself, charging a speeding violation. No indication that there's any kind of accident.
And how does a plaintiff acquire standing in this court?
And I asked that question because it's been ruled multiple times by higher courts that in order to acquire standing, a plaintiff needs to allege a violation of one of their rights. And they need to allege that because of that violation, they suffered some sort of injury, and thus they are entitled to some sort of damages or monetary compensation. And none of that is alleged on this ticket. She is, of course, aware that according to case law, the requirements for standing have not been met, so she defers me to statutory law in a way to get around that.
The city files a summons and complaint. One of the officers, in this case, the ticket indicates it's Officer Dennis Hallberg who signed it, badge number FCC 140.
Okay, and will I be allowed to cross-examine that officer if it does come to a proceeding?
If you plead not guilty and the case is set for trial, the city would certainly have the officer here to testify, yes, and you would have the opportunity to cross-examine. It does indicate that on the rights on that written advisement form that you reviewed. Number 5 says at trial to testify or not, to present evidence and cross-examine witnesses in the city.
Okay. apologize. Most of these questions that I came up with were actually geared towards the district attorney or the prosecuting attorney.
Again, this is my first time trying this approach that I learned from Mark, and I was not completely prepared as I did not exactly know what to expect, so I did make a few mistakes, and I went in there with the wrong armament for the wrong situation, but I made the best out of the situation that I could.
And you said he has the burden of proof in this. Does he have the burden of proof on every element of this crime?
The city has the burden of proof, yes, okay, with regard to the charge itself and all the elements.
And going into this, am I presumed innocent of the crime?
Certainly.
And am I presumed innocent of every element of the crime?
Certainly.
And is not jurisdiction an element of the crime?
Certainly.
So am I presumed innocent of jurisdiction then?
The city would have to allege, as they have in the summons and complaint, and have to prove that the incident happened within the city of Port Collins.
I'm not really a lawyer. I don't really understand most of this. I just need a yes or no. Am I presumed innocent of jurisdiction of this crime?
This is a question that she does not want to answer. The reason being is that if she admits that she presumes to not have jurisdiction, if she admits that she presumes me innocent of every element, including jurisdiction, that is basically her saying that she presumes not to be able to even hear the case. It's a fatal flaw in their system. It's necessary to uphold the veil of legitimacy that they have this propaganda, that they tell you that you're presumed innocent. They do not presume you innocent, but they tell you that they do. And when you look at just the jurisdiction element of the crime, it is obvious that they do not presume you innocent. But they will say so, and when you hold their feet to their fire, they get very uncomfortable.
That's an unusual way to form the question, is why I'm struggling. But that is an element of the offense that the city has to prove.
And so I am presumed innocent of jurisdiction.
You are presumed innocent of the charge itself.
So I'm not presumed innocent of all the elements of the crime. I just need to understand this before I go forward in it.
Yeah, and it's such an unusual question. I'm not sure how to answer it any differently than I already have.
Just with a yes or no.
I have to laugh at this point because most people, when they go into court with me and they see the way that I talk to judges and the way that I put them in their place, they're completely astonished and amazed. But just remember, these are people, and they're the lowest form of people. They're crooks. They're people that like to make their living off of stealing and bullying. And it's hard to talk to somebody who makes their living that way with any amount of respect. Most people do it out of fear. I don't really fear these people. We'll continue.
Well, I've already said you are presumed innocent of the charge. One of the elements of the charge is that it happened within the city of Fort Collins. So you're presumed innocent of the charge and all the elements thereof.
Okay, so if I'm presumed innocent of jurisdiction, does this court have the ability to proceed against me?
Yes, because the allegation is that it happened within the city of Fort Collins, and so it's appropriate to go ahead and proceed with the summons and complaint presented as it has been.
And if you listen to that last clip, you can tell that she's been caught on her lie, and she knows she's been caught, and you can hear the fear and the trembling in her voice, the choppiness in her voice. This is what happens when you stand up to a bully.
And who has to prove that I'm within the city of Fort Collins?
The city is the prosecution.
And do they have any facts on record to prove that I'm, even right now, within the city limits of Fort Collins?
Do they have any facts on record to prove that you're in the city of Fort Collins?
Uh-huh.
The prosecution would have to respond to that type of question.
See, most of these questions
You're getting into the charge itself. If you want to ask that the arraignment date be postponed for 2 weeks so you have time to file a written motion and the city can respond, and then we determine whether that motion is granted or not, and if not, if the motion to dismiss is denied, then it would be set for trial, and then you can have a trial on the charge itself if you choose.
Again, the question is too difficult for her to answer, so once again, I am deferred to the prosecutor. And that's her way of keeping herself out of the spotlight. We'll continue.
Okay. You already said that I am entitled to a fair and meaningful hearing, right?
Yes.
Okay. Could I get a fair and meaningful hearing if there was a conflict of interest?
I would assume you would argue no.
Again, she accuses me of arguing when I'm asking a question, and she says she assumes I would argue no, as if anybody would argue that, yes, a judge with a conflict of interest could offer a fair trial.
No, I'm asking you what the answer is. I'm not going to argue about it.
Well, what kind of conflict of interest are you talking about?
Well, if you represented a party to the proceedings, would that be a conflict of interest?
Certainly, I would not do that. And if there were any conflict that I had, I would recuse myself.
So you heard her say it, folks. She said that if she represented a party to the proceeding, it would be a conflict. And if that conflict existed, she would recuse herself.
Okay, you would recuse yourself. So you wouldn't seek to enforce any judgment against me if there was found to be a conflict of interest?
If there was I'm not sure what you mean.
If there was
a conflict of interest, we would deal with the conflict,
okay.
Remove the conflict before the case ever went to trial.
Okay.
If you go to trial and you're found guilty, then the court would enforce a judgment.
All right.
Collect the judgment.
And who do you represent in these proceedings?
I am hired by the City of Fort Collins as the municipal judge.
Okay, and who's the plaintiff in these proceedings?
It is the City of Fort Collins. It's stated as...
Oh, snap. She just said she represents the City of Fort Collins and is paid for by the City of Fort Collins. And when I asked her who the plaintiff to the proceedings was, she said that the plaintiff is also the City of Fort Collins. She realizes that she just admitted that she represents and is paid for by a party to the proceedings. And let's see how she tries to get out of this. A lot of backpedaling, a lot of stuttering, maybe? Let's find out.
See how they specifically has it worded. It's a charge, again, defendant, they allege that it's a charge committed against the people of the City of Fort Collins. At the top, it's in Fort Collins Municipal Court and for the City of Fort Collins. So it's City Attorney's Office representing the City of Fort Collins in general.
So you're being paid by the city, and the plaintiff is the city. And is that not a conflict of interest?
Not a conflict of interest.
It's not a conflict of interest? What is this bitch, crazy? She represents a party to the proceeding. She just 2 seconds ago said if she represents a party to the proceeding, it would be a conflict of interest. And now all of a sudden, it is not a conflict of interest.
In the county and district court systems, you're going to find a similar situation. It's the taxpayers that are paying the judge as well as the taxpayers paying the prosecution, which is a public official.
So you're saying on the record the fact that you're getting paid by the plaintiff is not a conflict of interest?
I am saying that.
Now, at this point, I should have had her explain how it could possibly not be a conflict of interest for her to represent and be paid for by a party to a proceeding. But this was my first time, and like I said, I made mistakes. So I continue.
Okay. Is this being recorded at all?
Yes.
And will I be... Is there ability for me to get a transcript or audio recording or something of this whole proceeding?
You can do that. You are recording it?
Yes, I am.
Okay. And you said that it does have to stay consistent with Supreme Court rulings. The Supreme Court rules that in order for a plaintiff to have standing to complain against somebody, that they have to prove... or plead an injury personal to themselves, and I'm not seeing any injury, and you stated that you're not aware of any injury being pled here.
And what I said is that the prosecution would have to address that. I'm going to stop you at this point because I think this really, a lot of what you're getting at is more appropriate in a motion to dismiss, and I'm going to ask that you do that in writing.
Can I just
so that
orally
the prosecution
dismiss?
Can,
no,
because the
right
prosecutors
now?
Are involved with pretrial conferences right now, so they're not available, and they would need time to review the case. So typically a motion to dismiss like this, I would ask that it be in writing, so I'm going to ask that in this case.
Okay.
And I'll ask that the bailiff have the clerk go ahead and postpone the arraignment for 2 weeks, give you time if you want to file a written motion to dismiss.
Okay.
Prosecutor will respond, and then I'll rule on it.
At this point in time, you can pretty much tell she just wants me to get the F out of her courtroom. She wants to get rid of me. She does not want to answer any more of my questions, and she keeps avoiding and putting me off to the prosecutor. And this is typical. This is usually what I get. As soon as I start asking any questions that get at the heart of what they're doing, this is usually the response I get. Get out of my courtroom. I don't need to answer these questions.
And if I do put in a motion to dismiss, do I give it to you and to the prosecutor, or just to the prosecutor?
You would file it with the court and give a copy to the prosecutor, and the copy filed with the court should indicate that you have given a copy to the other side, which in this case is the prosecution.
All right, and if I do make out a motion to dismiss, does the prosecutor have to address each issue that I bring up in the motion in order for you to deny it, or... I don't really understand.
It depends. Sometimes they will address each individual item. Sometimes they will give a general response. Sometimes if they feel that all of the items really relate to factual issues that are to be determined at trial, they'll just indicate that and ask that the motion be denied. It depends. That will be up to the prosecution as to how they respond to the motion.
And just for good measure, because I'm still confused on how she can represent a party and it not be a conflict of interest, I ask one more time.
Okay, and just one more last time, just so I'm 100% sure about this. You're saying that you are paid by the plaintiff, but that is not a conflict of interest.
And I've already answered that question.
Can I just get a yes or a no?
I'll have you go with the bailiff at this point.
Okay. All right, you have a good day.
You too.
So in recap, this judge proves herself to have a lot of patience, and thus, I get to ask a lot of questions, which is why I really like this audio. And also, she proves herself to be quite a liar and quite a manipulator of words and circumstances, which is also why I really like this audio. A few things that I do differently now, I make them explain. If they say something and it doesn't make sense to me, I demand that they explain. If she says... or if any judge says, it's not a conflict of interest, I hold their feet to the fire. I say, how could it not be a conflict of interest? If they say, well, the city has to prove this, I'll ask them, what do you mean when you say the city? What exactly is the city? What are you talking about? I don't let them just get away with using these words that have nothing to refer to them. I want them to give me the referent. I want to understand what they're saying. They need a voluntary and fully understood plea. I want to fully understand. Also, I don't beat them over the head. Usually I've found, since this incident, I have found that it's better just to get in, get out, make my point real quick, and let the cards fall where they may. If I've gotten through the first set of questions and a judge doesn't throw it out right then, beating them over the head with the facts is probably not the most effective thing to do. Continually trying to push them and force them is probably just going to get them more and more defensive. So I usually only go in with one set of questions now. What I like to go in with that I didn't go in with this particular time, and what I found to be most effective, at least at the judge level, is just to simply ask, Your Honor, is this court bound by the Constitution and Supreme Court rulings? They'll usually say yes, and then I'll say, okay, would I have to enter a plea if there wasn't a crime presented? And since there's not a crime presented, I've never had them answer that question once. Usually it's continuance or dismissed. But these are the things that you learn. Subsequently, I learned that when you go in there and beat a judge over the head with the fact that they're a fraud, then every time you go before that judge again, as is the case with this lady, they usually don't care. The last time I went before this lady, I had cops, like 6 or 7 cops in the courtroom taking pictures of me. I got a ticket in the parking lot of the court while I was in there. And when I was leaving the court, I got followed by 5 or 6 police cars and ticketed again for the exact same infraction that they ticketed me for while I was in court. So this judge was very threatened by this, and I would only be able to say that the reason I believe that they feel so threatened that they go to such extreme measures is because their entire lifestyle, their entire reality is built on a house of cards. Their authority is built on a house of cards. When you start questioning them, it's like pulling out one of the bottom cards, and pretty soon their entire reality comes falling down. And when that happens, and when the people realize that the emperor has no clothes, these people are going to have to go out and get real jobs. These people are going to have to get jobs where they get paid on a voluntary basis like the rest of us. And most of these people have no idea how to do anything except for bully people and steal from them. And there's not much need for that in the job market. So they need to hold on to their positions of authority, because otherwise they are useless to society. And that's got to be a pretty scary position to be in. So don't expect them to go down without a fight.
From victim of the state to victory over the state. Listen to Live Free FM with Paranoid, Saturday nights at 10 p.m. Eastern, on Orion Talk Radio.